Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Probably Private. Today we're gonna talk more about AI model memorization or deep learning memorization, which you've been exploring. And we're gonna try to now analyze how is it that we could have observed this behavior through other channels. So basically, how could we have known that AI models memorize parts of their training data? In doing so, we're going to explore differential privacy in machine learning. Now, you may have heard about differential privacy, but I'm going to walk you through a mini primer. To start with differential privacy, we have one database of a bunch of examples, and then we add or remove a person from that database. So now the database has changed by one person, and we call that database two. So database one, database two. And to walk you through a very, very simple definition of differential privacy is essentially we imagine that an attacker or somebody maybe that's curious has the ability to query the database before the person is added, and then the database after the person is added or removed. And they're trying to figure out was a person added or removed, and they may also be trying to figure out things about that person. And what we can see in the underneath, if you know anything about probability theory, is we essentially want to respond to this user's queries in a way that limits the amount of information they can learn. Essentially, we want them to not be able to figure out whether a person was added or removed. And if they can figure it out, we want them to be pretty uncertain about if they've figured it out or not. We want them to have very low confidence in their model or in their intuition around whether the response came from database one or database two. So to read through the math on the bottom, we have the probability that is database one given the response divided by the probability that is database two over given the response. So this kind of information from the response changing our opinion on the left side, and we want to keep that less than or equal to e to the epsilon. So that's e to the power of epsilon. Epsilon is a parameter we can tune, so we can make the bounds a little bit bigger or smaller. But obviously, the bigger we make the bounds, the less privacy we have. And the smaller we make the bounds, the more clear that we have these tight guarantees, so to speak. So that the amount of information, how I can update my posterior based off of the response, should be less than or equal to e to the epsilon times the actual probability of those two changes. So that could be potentially a constant, or at least a normalized term. And so when we think through this, we're basically, again, trying to make it almost imperceptible that somebody has been added or removed because this has great privacy guarantees. If I can say, guess what, for every individual, I can guarantee that we can't figure out if they're in the data set or not. And yet we can still make analytics, make inference, make machine learning models, end-to-end. With the overall information that comes from many, many people, not just one person, then this is both promise of differential privacy and also a really cool kind of way of saying we can guarantee individual privacy while still allowing us to do data work and make conclusions, come to conclusions from larger groups of persons. One of the first ways of applying differential privacy in machine learning, one of the first papers that got a lot of attraction, was private aggregation of teacher ensembles or PATE. And so PATE was this idea of can we apply differential privacy to deep learning? And if so, how should we do it? And it was Papanot, and there'll be a link in the description below. And the idea was okay, first we need to divide up the data set so that we know which parts of the data have what people. And this goes back to the differential privacy. We have to kind of try to divide the data so we know what one individual coming or going from a data set, what they can contribute. Then you have these data in all these different chunks and you train many different small teachers. So you just train machine learning models on whatever task it is that you have. So I think in this case, it might have been text classification in the original paper. So let's say we're trying to classify whether a comment was positive or negative, just very basic. So sentiment analysis on some comments. So we're going to divide these up. We're going to make sure that one user only appears in one data. And so each teacher has only seen a small amount of the users. And then those teachers go to form an aggregate teacher. And this aggregate teacher's job is essentially to teach a now differentially private student model. How does that happen? Basically, public data that doesn't have labels is coming in. The student is trying to learn and update weights or whatever the original architecture was. And they basically get the label from the teacher. But the teacher gives a differentially private response, which means this aggregate teacher, all of the different teachers have essentially a vote. They create a distribution that says, 90 teachers think that this is positive, and two teachers think that this is negative. And then that teacher only responds with the aggregate answer. Another crucial step in differential privacy that we use when we do differentially private responses is we add very carefully constructed noise. And so when this initial 90 and 2 is constructed, we have the real answer, which might be 90 and 2. And then we have the differential privacy answer, which is actually what is used. And maybe let's say then that's like 85 and 4. So it's changed a little bit, but because most teachers answered yes, they still are in the majority. Then that becomes a label, and this can respond. So this is a pretty interesting architecture when it first came out, because as far as I remember in my career, it was one of the kind of breakthrough moments of thinking through differential privacy at scale in deep learning. Of course, this requires a lot of data. So at scale is specific here to companies that had enough scale that they could do something like this. And then they could say that the student that learned, that it actually learned in a way that we can consider, for example, anonymized, and therefore no longer relevant for numerous types of data protection requirements. And what's really interesting, if you start thinking about this problem of memorization, and you might remember that memorization specifically happens with highly repeated examples, but then also with really unique, novel examples that are also indicative of something that the model should learn. And what we saw with PATE is they published this also in the paper. These were the ones, so here's the image is above, and then the label is below, the true label. And these were the ones that PATE had near misses, where it didn't get it correctly. And we can see that for a lot of these are anomalies. These are special in some way. A, we have probably some mislabeled stuff here. The fourth one in, to me, that looks like a mu symbol, an M, but it's labeled as a U. Yeah, I guess it could be U too, but it's hard even as a human. The commas and apostrophes, those are hard. How do I know if it's a comma or apostrophe? And we see also that we have some characters, some non-ASCII characters that are encoded as a plus, right? Probably because it had to be encoded in something in ASCII range for this data set. So these are things that it got wrong compared to a model that didn't have any differential privacy. And we can see exactly these are maybe the types of sometimes mislabeled uncommon examples and sometimes things we actually want to learn uncommon examples. And that was further studied in another piece of research from Carlini et al. I think this one, which I'll also link, which looks at, sorry, the video's over it, but these are hard examples. These are uncommon examples to the left. And then we have easy examples to the right. So things that are easy, things that are general, we can learn these with differential privacy. But these edge cases or really uncommon cases, we tend not to learn them with differential privacy because, again, think back. We want to make sure that you don't know if this one example is in the training set or not. We want to make the uncertainty about any one particular example and the amount of information that example can convey to our machine learning model, we want to make that a bit fuzzy. We want to reduce that compared to its neighbors, compared to other of its class. And so when we do that, we make sure that we don't memorize these novel examples, but then we also get this trade-off in our accuracy, where when we have another really weird example, if you remember those high influence pairs, when we have another really weird example, but that's similar to something that we didn't actually learn in this case, because it was an outlier, because it was uncommon, then we now get those wrong. And I'm curious to hear your thoughts about this. I'm curious to also hear your own thoughts around differential privacy and deep learning. Do you think this is an interesting topic? And stay tuned for more ways that we could have maybe figured out that memorization was happening.